The usual practice was for the crew of a tank to paint a white ring around the gun barrel for every enemy tank destroyed. Some crews were so successful in this practice that a thick white ring had to be painted, representing 10 kills. The most successful commanders proudly carried an array of kill rings like so many strutting peacocks. With the noise inside a tank, communication is very difficult. To communicate with other vehicles is almost impossible. The German engineers solved the problem by an internal intercom, which linked the crew and allowed them to communicate via headphones and microphones.
German practice at the time was to use a throat mic, which had two little microphones up against the side of your throat, and you would press those whenever you wanted to speak to the rest of the crew. If you then switched the radio set over, that also allowed you to broadcast to the rest of your unit. The headset has a pair of headphones on, so it muffles a little bit the sound of the engine, but it's a very, very loud engine anyway.
For communications between the tanks themselves, all German machines were equipped with radios. In the early war years, there were no such refinements on the Russian side.
In the T-34, strangely enough, as good as the tank was, even from its very beginning, the communication was very poor because it had no radios, which is a normal way of doing things. The T-34 actually, the early ones, the commander had to get out of his turret at least halfway and wave two flags about, one red and one green one, I believe, and give signals like ships at high seas, you see. And that's how they changed directions or whatever he wanted them to do, which was very primitive, and it didn't work very well. It was only much later, for instance, the tank behind me, the T-34/85, the bigger one, had proper radio and radio contact within each crew member, and of course to headquarters as well.
The superior communications gave the Germans a great advantage, which compensated for their very real disadvantage in armor quality. During World War II, most German tanks started the conflict at a disadvantage. The puny 37mm gun was initially used to equip the Panzer IIIs, which were then Germany's main battle tanks. The same 37mm gun was also carried by all of the Czech-made 38T tanks, which, in 1940, were Germany's most numerous tanks. These guns were insufficient to penetrate at all but the shortest range, and even the upgrade to a 50mm gun, such as those carried by these Panzer IIIs, was still not really sufficient. Only the 75mm gun of the Panzer IV and Sturmgeschütz battalions were really suited to the demands of the modern battlefield, but even then, it had its limitations. The short barrel of the 75mm gave the shells only a limited velocity, which was effective against the thinly armored tanks of the early war years, but proved to be totally inadequate when the Germans met the superior Russian tanks during 1941.
The T-34 at its time was by far away the best tank the world had ever seen. It was absolutely second to none. The shape is followed even to this day, the outline of a tank. It was a mother, so to speak, of all modern tanks. It was just right in every respect. The gun, the armor, the speed, the lot.
To compensate for the low quality of the guns, the Germans further extended their technological lead by introducing special command tanks, which had the main guns removed to make room for additional radio equipment.
Command tanks are basically factory or battlefield conversions of ordinary gun tanks, which are used by relatively senior tank commanders, squadron, company, battalion or regiment commanders, to observe and to coordinate the actions of their subordinates on the battlefield. Command tanks generally mount extra radios, wireless sets for these purposes, and in order to incorporate these extra wireless sets and sometimes extra wireless operators, something usually has to be removed from the tank. Generally speaking, this is either ammunition, which is extremely bulky, or the main armament of the tank itself. Obviously, removing either, and particularly the latter, considerably disadvantages a command tank on the battlefield.
The cohesion which came from a smooth flow of commands was one of the obvious reasons that the inferior German tanks of 1941 and 1942 were able to overcome the superior T-34s and KV-1s. These command tanks soon drew special attention, and attempts were made to disguise them with dummy guns.
A command tank is frequently without a main gun, so that it was made to look a little bit like the appropriate tank with a length of wood or pipe.
Even where a dummy gun was used, however, usually the extra wireless antennae, which were installed on the tank to make the extra wireless sets work effectively, were another way with which the enemy could identify enemy command tanks and knock them out.
This disconcerting factor was not mitigated by the rigid German practice of numbering their tanks in sequence, starting with the commander's vehicle, which frequently carried the number 001, displayed prominently on the turret. A sure invitation to enemy gunners. By 1943, a command vehicle was no place to be. Infantry had, by now, developed extra killing power in the form of magnetic mines, bazookas, and the Panzerfausts. These deadly weapons could all blast through the armor of a tank, but the Russians found that the simple expedient of a bottle filled with petrol, lighted, and thrown onto the engine decks could disable even the largest tanks. Their tank-hunting teams soon became very adept at wielding this single, improvised tank-killing device. The tanks, which the Russians stalked so effectively, were designed to do two jobs on the battlefield. The first was to engage and destroy other tanks. The second was to attack infantry and artillery targets. In essence, the successful engagement and destruction of enemy tanks was a matter of the simple application of brute force. Elementary physics tells us that force equals mass times velocity. For the job of destroying other tanks, the tank needs to be able to fire the heaviest practicable shell at huge speeds. This produces enough force to punch through the armor of an enemy tank. Explosive power alone has little value against the thick armor of a tank. What gives the missile its penetrating power is the enormous velocity which punches through the armor of enemy vehicles.
Armor-piercing rounds, very simply, tend generally to be solid shot, by which I mean a shell which is essentially metal with a very small explosive charge, and which relies upon a very high velocity and the enormous pressures and heat created by a round impacting on armor in order to burn their way or melt their way through the armor of, say, a turret or a tank generally, and to splatter around inside, either destroying equipment or killing or injuring the crew.
Very occasionally, it was found that armor-piercing shells were traveling so fast they passed straight through enemy tanks and through the other side, without damaging the vehicle or its occupants. A variety of high-explosive anti-tank rounds were therefore developed, which were designed to first penetrate the armor of an enemy tank, then explode inside the vehicle. This fine balancing act was rarely achieved in practice, and it is debatable whether the small amount of explosive contained in the shells was much more effective than the massive kinetic impact of a high-velocity round. Against infantry and field guns, the tank needs to be able to fire a high-explosive round. Here, the speed of the shell is less important. What matters is the weight of explosive packed into the warhead. The bigger the shell, the bigger the explosion. To to reach over walls and intervening obstacles. A plunging trajectory is the best method of attack.